We have a few announcements we want to draw your attention to before we start the song service. Notice, ladies, that there's a ladies' tea on the 1st of June. It's a Saturday morning from 10:30 to 12. That date has been moved from May to the 1st of June, so please make note of that. We have life groups this Wednesday at the Polsons, at the Sam and Tricia Lewis's house, and at our house on Wednesday night, and then again next Sunday. So if you're in those life groups, or if you'd like to visit a life group, we'd like to welcome you. The addresses are in the bulletin. No choir rehearsal today, but we just wanted to thank you. Pastor is traveling. Some of you might have seen on Facebook that his daughter received her PhD at Notre Dame on Friday or Saturday. It was a big day. So certainly proud of her and excited for them. This time we'll go ahead and get started on the song service. Warren.
The redeemed love to be together and sing about the great redemption. So let's stand and sing with all our hearts and all our voices. Go together to the Lord in prayer. God, you're so good to us. God, your grace is displayed in our lives in so many ways, so that if we did have 1,000 tongues, we could sing for all of eternity, and we will sing for all of eternity to praise you for all the ways that you have graced us and brought glory to yourself. God, thank you especially for your grace displayed in breaking the power of canceled sin and setting those of us who are bound in slavery to our sin, setting us free. God, thank you for, through your gospel, giving us new life. Lord, giving us eternal life. Thank you, God, for gracing us with the gifts of your Spirit so that we can minister to one another, even today as we gather together. Our singing together is a ministry of grace, and speaking your word together is a ministry of your grace, and seeing one another serve in various ways is a ministry of your grace. And so, God, we are together today praising you for all the ways you've shown your grace to us. Thank you, Father, for these gifts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Again of the redemption.
Thank you. We have offering boxes in the back and up here in the front to receive your offering. Thank you for your faithful giving. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for just the ability that you have given to so many in this congregation to create wealth and then to share it with your people. We pray that you would guide us in the office as we spend the tithes and offerings that come in, that they would be used wisely to spread the gospel in this community, that souls would be saved and that your kingdom would abound. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Thank you, Gene and Lance, for that. That was beautiful. Scripture reading this morning is going to be Psalm 145. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall command your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. It shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who were bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all the flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Amen.
Singing about the redemption. This is Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound, and it has a refrain, My Chains Fell Off. So Amy's going to sing the first stanza and refrain, and then we're going to stand and rejoice with her. Okay.
Not
Amen. Thank you, Warren and Amy and Jean, Lance, for leading us in worship this morning. And thank you, congregation, for participating in worship this morning as well. That song is a real blessing. It's nice sometimes to have a new framing of an old song. It helps us refocus on the text in a way that's fresh and new and special. I read about John Newton, who wrote that song, and I think one of the original titles of it was Faith's Review and Expectation, before it came to be known as Amazing Grace. And if you think through the verses, we sang a newer verse that was an older verse today, maybe for some of you. There are more verses than we typically sing of that song, but you think of that song, and it does. It looks back at what we were before Christ saved us and what Jesus did to bring us to God through his sacrifice and his life and what we have to look forward to. 10,000 years really is just a drop in the bucket of eternity. And what a blessing to know the Lord, to know that Christ is our Redeemer. And we're so thankful for that. And we're going to talk about this maybe from an unusual place, Haggai chapter 1. If you want to turn your Bibles there. We're going to talk about the blessings and glory of God and our priorities, both in the time of Israel's history and our own current opportunity today. I stood several years ago in front of a larger-than-life statue of David Livingstone. It's a place where it's claimed that he viewed for the first time what was called in the local language then, Masai Atanya, or the smoke that thunders. It was there that the great Zambezi River plunges into a gorge, the full width of the river and a single vertical drop about 350 feet in the center. The chasm is over 5,000 feet wide. It's an amazing sight. Of course, Livingstone renamed that site as Victoria Falls after Queen Victoria at the time, and Livingstone gave his energies and life to exploring the interior of Africa for the sake of the gospel. On December 4th, 1857, Livingstone was talking to some students at Cambridge about his, quote, leaving the benefits of England to do what God had called him to do. He said to them, "For my own part, I've never ceased to rejoice that God has appointed me to such an office. People talk about the sacrifice that I made spending so much of my life in Africa. Is it a sacrifice," he said, "that brings its own blessed reward in healthful activity, the conscientiousness of doing good, peace of mind, a bright hope of a glorious destiny hereafter? Away with such a word and such a view, with such a thought. It is emphatically no sacrifice. Say rather, it's a privilege. Anxiety and sickness and suffering, danger now and then, with a foregoing of some common conveniences and charities of this life, may make us pause. It causes my spirit to waver, causes my soul to sink. But let this only be for a moment. All of these are nothing when compared to the glory which shall be revealed in and for us. I never made a sacrifice," he said. One of the surprising things about Livingstone was his normalcy. He grew up in a normal family as a teen, felt the burden of God to go, and was encouraged by a loving and godly father to give his life for the church and missions. In spite of common normalcy, most of us may not be called to do what he was called to do, to explore an interior place where the gospel has not yet been named. We may not be called to that, or we might be called, and if we are, we should obey and go. But all of us have a clear calling of God and equipping for building the body of Christ and sharing the gospel to those who are around us. And it's not a sacrifice at all to make the priority of our lives that pursuit, the glory of God and the spread of the gospel. It's actually a sacred duty. It's something that we should do in place of the normal pursuit of the pleasures of life in our culture and the pleasures of the world that interfere with it. Paul says in the book of Romans, chapter 15, "Whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. So we're going to look at maybe an unusual text for this kind of theme, Haggai chapter 1. So go ahead and turn there if you haven't already to Haggai chapter 1. Haggai is like the third or fourth from the last book of the Old Testament. If you want to back up from Malachi, Zechariah, there's Haggai. It's the third from the last book of the Old Testament. Here in this short book, we have an exhortation by the prophet Haggai to the people to give priority to the work and worship of God so that he might be pleased and glorified, and that they might actually experience God's presence and blessing according to his good providence. We find ourselves in similar circumstances today. We have to set priorities in our life, and sometimes we feel we have competing priorities. Sometimes we feel if we give up on one thing, we're going to lose out if we're going to give our attention to something else. And God tells us through the prophet Haggai that actually making God's work and pursuing his glory and his will give us the greatest blessings in our lives, regardless of the things that seem to pull on our attention. The prophet Haggai is here mentioned in this book, of course, and in Ezra chapter 5 and chapter 6. He's linked with Zechariah as a post-exile prophet and may have written some psalms as well. Not much else is known about him, though. He's not really mentioned in the rest of the scripture. But we have this message from him today. One writer said that usually you hear this message preached when a church is going through a building program, right? Providing an opportunity to guilt people who are living in fine houses into giving more to provide for a church building program. Well, that's not really the purpose of this passage. Far from Haggai being an old prophetic building program proponent, he actually, in this context of remnant Jews, provides an encouraging pattern of self-evaluation for them and encourages them through the benefits of prioritizing the work of God, the benefits that they will themselves reap in blessings. And so today I want us to focus on this proposition when it comes to this text as the people of God. When we pursue our desires above God's priorities for our lives, we're going to find our efforts to be frustrating and unrewarding. And that is a grace of the providence of God. However, when we pursue God's priorities, God is glorified, he is with us in our pursuits, and we find blessing and satisfaction in accomplishing his will. It's a simple truth, but one that is so important for us today when we live lives in the midst of so many competing voices that call for our priorities to give less and less attention to the work of the Lord through his church. Let's join God's people here in Haggai's call to consider our ways, literally, to set our heart upon our ways and have a heart-searching evaluation of the priorities we have in our lives. And I want to do this in a very positive way because I think that's the way the Lord does it. He calls them to consider, perhaps to repent, but also he calls them to consider the Lord's blessing if they serve him effectively. Let's consider the present situation and what this reveals to the people of Haggai. Haggai chapter 1, let me read verses 1 through 11. The prophet says, in the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, on the first day of the month, the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Thus says the Lord of hosts, these people say the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. Then the word of the Lord came by the hand of Haggai the prophet. Is it a time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses while this house lies in ruins? Now therefore, thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. You have sown much and harvested little. You eat, but you have never have enough. You drink, but you never have your fill. You clothe yourselves, but no one is warm. And he who earns wages does so to put them into a bag with holes. Thus says the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Go up to the hills and bring wood and build the house that I may take pleasure in it, that I may be glorified, says the Lord. You looked for much, and behold, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away. Why, declares the Lord of hosts? Because my house that lies in ruins, while each of you busies himself with his own house. Therefore, the heavens above you have withheld the dew, and the earth has withheld its produce. And I have called for a drought on the land and the hills, on the grain, the new wine, the oil, on the ground that brings forth, on man and beast, and on all their labors. Then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God, and the words of Haggai the prophet, as the Lord their God had sent him. And the people feared the Lord. Then Haggai, the messenger of the Lord, spoke to the people with the Lord's message. I am with you, declares the Lord. And the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and the spirit of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. And they came and worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God, on the 24th day of the month, in the sixth month, in the second year of Darius the king. What is called God called us to do? What did God call these people to do? Well, they needed to consider their present situation and what that revealed in their lives. The first thing they needed to consider is that they were not giving due effort to accomplishing what God had called them and given them the ability to accomplish. We see that in the first five verses. What work had God called them to do? He called them to rebuild the temple, to rebuild the house of the Lord, to make it a priority to provide a place of worship for God's people. It's very simple in the historical context. This is implied in a number of phrases in the resulting command of God. He says, it's the time in verse 2 for the house of the Lord to be rebuilt. In verse 4, he says it negatively, the house of the Lord is lying desolate. Some historical context. The Babylonian Empire under Nebuchadnezzar II had destroyed Jerusalem and the temple in 586 BC. That's one of those dates sometimes you remember from history class, right? 586 BC. And he carried off most and the best of the people captive to Babylon. They were called exiles. The people and their worship was threatened with extinction. In 538 BC, about 50 years later, the king of Persia, Cyrus, instituted a new policy. He allowed the Jews and others to return to their homeland and rebuild their centers of worship. He had kind of a cultural-centric idea that it'd be better for the empire if people returned to their places and reestablished their religions and places of worship in their cities and such. And so at this point, Zerubbabel led about 50,000 Jews. Could you imagine 50,000 people taking off into captivity somewhere for 50 years? It's about as long as I've been alive. That's what happened. And now they return back to their homeland. The book of Ezra records some of the events here in Ezra 3 that Zerubbabel and Joshua the priest built an altar on the ruins of the temple to offer sacrifices again. So they kind of started the work of rebuilding the temple by rebuilding the altar. And in the next year, 536, the foundation was laid for the new temple. This is recorded in Ezra chapter 3, verse 10. And then some people around them, some of the peoples that lived in the neighboring lands started discouraging the people. They frightened them. They threatened them. They sent threats back to the emperor about what the people were doing in rebuilding their temple. They sent accusations to Cyrus. This is recorded in Ezra chapter 4. And so the people became afraid and they stopped the work of rebuilding the temple. And then we come to our context here in August. The dates are very clear. August of 520 BC, this is about 16 years after this, that Haggai speaks to the people of Israel about continuing the work of the Lord. And this account now takes place in what was called the Peace of Persia during the reign of King Darius over the Persian Empire. The Jews had returned to the area around Jerusalem. They settled there. They began the work of rebuilding the temple, but now had stopped and given attention instead. And this sometimes makes sense to us. They gave attention to rebuilding their own homes, reestablishing their own farms, their own agriculture, a way of making a living, because they were expecting to be settling there and living there for the foreseeable future. However, the quickness with which they neglected the building of the temple and turned their attention to building their own homes and establishing their own crops was something that got God's attention. And this caused Haggai to lament that the house of the Lord was neglected. And his burden was that this be addressed, and the people do all they could in spite of still having limited resources to build the house of the Lord and make it a priority that they worship and glorify God. And part of the priority of having a temple was so that they could proclaim God's glory to the nations surrounding them and tell about the wondrous works of their God. Part of the purpose of the temple was to do that. And so really reestablish the mission of God's people in their land by proclaiming the glories of God. Now, how does this apply to us today? It's a great historical lesson, right? I feel like some of you are like, I'm sitting in history class, I'm about to doze off. Well, I just taught a course in hermeneutics over at Bob Jones, and one of my goals there was to tell them, how do we take a historical passage like this from the Old Testament, and how do we make the cultural jump to where we are today? We're not called to rebuild a temple. Some people, you know, think, man, if we could just rebuild that temple, things would be just right. Well, Christ is going to take care of that someday. Our calling is not to rebuild the temple, but it is to build the church, to build the temple of God, which is the people of God, to build it up. What are the priorities of the Christian age? Our priority is not to attract people to worship God through temple worship, but our priority is to go and tell people to worship God through turning from their sins and believing in the finished work of Jesus Christ as their Savior. We're called to make disciples of the nations. Matthew 28 says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. How easy is it for us as God's people to neglect the mission of taking the gospel to the ends of the earth? It's really easy for us to do that because it's really difficult for us to accomplish that mission, to send our loved ones, to go ourselves, to take the gospel to difficult places that have already rejected the truth of Christianity and reject the people that come and tell the message of the gospel. It's a difficult task we're called to do, and yet we are called to do it. We're to be going, continually going and making disciples of all the nations and baptizing them and forming local churches in places that need the gospel. Romans 12, 1 and 2 says we're to live as a holy people, living sacrifice to God. We're no longer called to sacrifice animals on the altar of the Old Testament temple, but we are called to live as sacrifices unto God, to be living sacrifices, to present our bodies as a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is our spiritual service of worship. We're no longer to put sacrifices to death in order to atone for sins, but we are to live as sacrifices to proclaim the glories of God in our lives. Always mindful of doing this and being transformed and doing it more and more and more. Ephesians 2:10 says we're to focus on doing good works through the church and in our society, in our communities. The Bible says we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for what? So we might enjoy a lot of blessings. No, we're created in Christ Jesus for good works. We should walk in them and live according to what Ephesians 1 says, to the praise of the glory of his grace. We're to be do-gooders, always doing good works where we are planted, where we are placed. We're to be those who are tuned into the fact that we need to do what is good, not necessarily what is best for us. 1 Corinthians 12:7 says we're to have an impact for good, building up the local church. We're to make it a priority to build up the church through serving, using our Spirit-given gifts. Ephesians 2:21 says, so then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but your fellow citizens with the saints and are part of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building, being fitted together, is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are being built together into a dwelling of God by the Spirit. Can you see the cultural jump that we can make with this text, giving a priority to building the temple of God, which is the people of God in the New Testament, the church, and we do that through all of us using our Spirit-given gifts to minister to one another, to build up the body unto the Lord as a spiritual sacrifice to him, to glorify him. And God supplies the means of this growth, just like he supplied what they needed to build the temple. He supplies the means of growth for us. by speaking the truth in love, Ephesians 4 says, we're going to hit all these passages through Pastor Lonnie's sermon series, right? Speaking the truth in love, we're to grow up in all aspects unto him who is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body is fitted and held together by what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part. This causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. We are each, brother and sister, each of us are called to have clearly as our priority the building up of the body of Christ through the witness of the gospel as we bring more people into the body of Christ, and through the service, Spirit-given gift service to one another as we build each other up in the body of Christ. We're to evangelize and disciple, and this takes a lot of time and effort and resources and perhaps what might seem initially sacrifice, but it's an investment in the glory of God and the good of our brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. So, back to the historical setting, why is this work being neglected by those people, and what lessons can we learn from their neglect of the work of God? Well, in verse 2, Scripture says, thus says the Lord of hosts, these people say, the time has not yet come to rebuild the house of the Lord. These people say the time has not yet come. Why is the work being neglected? Well, their response shows some measure of loyalty. They say to the Lord, the time has not yet come. They acknowledge that this is the house of the Lord that they're to rebuild, but yet they're not doing it. And God addresses them as, notice, these people, not my people. It's an interesting, you know, just one word, but it's an interesting thing to note that God addresses him, the Lord of hosts, who the Lord of all things, of all armies, the most powerful, one of the most powerful names given to God in the Old Testament. The Lord of hosts said, these people, not my people, because they're not acting like his people. He's confronting them. In essence, they were deciding when the time would be right to do God's work. They were deciding when they would have enough material goods, their houses would be in good enough shape, their crops would be established enough in order to then give themselves to the work of God. They were making sovereigns out of themselves, not upholding the Lord of hosts as their one true sovereign. You know, every one of us can be a king if we make our kingdom small enough, right? You might see a man ruling over his small family in his small yard, thinks himself a king, thinks himself the sovereign of his life because he's made his kingdom very small. Well, brothers and sisters, God's kingdom is vast, and he rules over it, and we are his subjects. We're to do his will and accomplish his work for his glory and not our own. May it never be that the Lord would look at us and say, this person, this man and this woman, not my child, my son, my daughter, because we're giving ourselves to the work of the Lord. Their response also shows their apathy for the work of the Lord. They say the time has not yet come for this house to be rebuilt. You might put a spiritual spin on this explanation. The time has not yet come. Maybe it was a pious excuse. They're waiting for God to drop off a load from Home Depot, you know, back then, right on their doorstep, some wood and all the stuff they needed just to put it together. Maybe it was a pious excuse, but most likely it was just a plain excuse for delaying the work of God. I like what Matthew Henry says about this passage. He says, there is an aptness in us to misinterpret providential discouragements. That is, they were having trouble growing their crops. They were having trouble making ends meet with their finances. They were having trouble being satisfied with the food and the drink that they had. There's an aptness in us to misinterpret providential discouragements in our duty as if they amounted to a discharge from our duty, when they're only intended for the trial and exercise of our courage and faith. It is bad to neglect our duty, but it is worse to vouch providence for the patronizing of our neglects. Sometimes this is seen in a kind of an open door philosophy of fill in the blank. You know, if God opens the door and paves the way and makes it smooth and greases the skids, okay, I'll do it. But if there's any measure of difficulty, then perhaps it's not an open door. Yet God has clearly called me to do it, right? That's what some of what's going on here. It seems to be going on in their mind. It's probably a circumstantial explanation and excuse for us. There were people around them opposing their work. They were struggling to meet their own needs, and so they failed to prioritize the work of God. And essentially, their excuses resulted in 16 years of procrastination. 16 years. Sometimes we make those kind of excuses. I know I was tempted to, and my kids were born. I'm like, I need to give attention to them rather than the work of the Lord. 16 years later, the kids are teenagers and getting ready to head off to college, and maybe I've neglected giving priority to the work of the Lord. Now, I don't want to say we should neglect our responsibilities in order to just serve the Lord. It doesn't have to be an either or. It can be a both and. Embrace the priorities and responsibilities God's given to you while embracing the priorities He's clearly laid out before us. And that's what these people were failing to do. Sometimes we think, man, I need to get so much money in my bank account before I can actually be generous towards someone else. Or I have to get my house in this kind of condition before I can give attention to giving time to serving in the church. And God's response shows the true reason for their failure. They had supplanted God's work with their own work. They would replace the pursuit of God's pleasure with their own pleasure. They had replaced a desire for God's glory with seeking their own glory and the accumulation and satisfaction in their own possessions. He kind of hits on this issue of paneled houses in verse 4. He says, is it time for you yourselves to dwell in your paneled houses while my house lies in ruin? I don't know about you, but we moved into a house here in 2015, and the whole living room was paneling, and we ripped all the paneling down and put up drywall, right? Paneling to us seemed out of date and old-fashioned, but in that culture, paneling was absolutely a luxury. It was an accoutrement. It was decor. It was something that made their houses more comfortable. And so God confronts them with making their houses more comfortable without rebuilding His house. And so it was a direct rebuke of the priorities that they had set for their own life. They wanted to finish their own place, provide for their own comforts, promote their own prosperity. And this was in direct contrast with promoting the worship of God and the witness of God to the nations surrounding them. It's easy to allow things like this to become the accepted norm in our own lives. Everyone's doing it. Everyone makes these priorities. It's just part of living in our society and in our culture. And friends, we cannot neglect the mission of Christ and the work of the church for being accepted in our culture. In verse 9, he says, each of you runs to his own house or busies himself with his own house while my house lies in ruins. God's clear call in their life was to make it a priority to rebuild His house. And they needed to be confronted about their lack of making this a priority in their life. Be careful that we don't allow the critical to become the priority or the squeaky wheel to get the grease, right? Our actions express our priorities, as Gandhi said famously. Elizabeth Elliot said, the will of God is not something you add to your life. It's actually a course of life that you choose. You either line yourself up with the Son of God or you capitulate to the principle that governs the rest of the world in ordering our priorities. God calls us to consider our ways. God's people were not giving effort to accomplishing His will, doing what He had called them to do, and using the abilities He had given them to do His will. And because of this, God graciously frustrated their efforts in His providence. Chapter 1, verse 6, verses 9 through 11 give us several examples of where God in His providence actually frustrated their selfish efforts. It says in verse 6, it says, you have sown much and harvested little. It wasn't the work of sowing that was a problem. It was the fact that they thought, if I just sowed a little more, I would get a little more. And they were finding the more they sowed, the less they harvested. They had plenty of provisions. They eat and drink, but they weren't satisfied with what they had. It was as if they were having more and more of a desire for eating and drinking as they saw that as an end in itself. They had plenty of clothing the Bible says. You clothe yourself, but no one is warm. They have the clothing they need to be warm, but they're not feeling warm enough. And finally, this picture is one that's very appropriate. He who earns wages does so to put them into a bag with holes. They were trying to accumulate security in their own wages, and it was as if they were putting them into a purse that had holes in it. And so they were losing coins along the way. It's a great thing to find a $20 bill on the side of the road, right? We're in a building, someone drops, but you always have that sense of, it's too bad that that person dropped that money. They probably needed it for something. And God in his providence was frustrating the efforts of his people to find their security in their own provision, in their own agriculture, in their own homes. He graciously frustrated those attempts. And God revealed to them that since they're not accomplishing his work, they're actually not being satisfied. Though they were sowing much, they were gathering relatively little. Though they ate and drank, they were not satisfied with what they ate and drank. Though they were being warmed by their clothing, they didn't feel warm enough. And though they had wages sufficient for their needs, they were wasting those wages as if they were in a bag with holes. They were not being satisfied. And the reason they're not being satisfied is a gift of God's providential grace. But maybe the worst thing that they're confronted with is that their wrong priorities actually brought the direct opposition of God himself. In verse 9, he says, "You looked for much, and behold, it came to little. And when you brought it home, I blew it away." It wasn't just that they weren't satisfied in the things that they could themselves produce, but actually, because they were not prioritizing the work of God, God then set himself in opposition to their work and the results of their work. They would bring their crops home and God would blow them away. They would bring their money home and God would blow them away. They would clothe themselves and God would produce a cool breeze that made them cold. God put himself in opposition to them. It shows God's direct hand in frustrating their efforts. Verse 10 and 11 are even more clear. "Therefore, the heavens above you have withheld the dew, and the earth has withheld its produce. And I have called for a drought on the land and on the hills and on the grain and the new wine, the oil and the ground, what the ground brings forth, on man and beast, and on all their labors." God set himself even more specifically in opposition to the growth of their crops and the production of the things that they needed in order to survive. It seemed like the more and more self-centered they tried to be, the more and more God withheld his blessing from the results of their labor. And the reason was that God was being gracious. God was turning their attention to remind them that they needed to prioritize his work and to prioritize his will in the efforts that they give in their lives. God is gracious in his judgment, even. Sometimes we think God shows his grace in the blessings we enjoy. And we rightly think that. God shows his grace in the many blessings that we enjoy. But God also shows his grace in the discipline that we endure and encounter. And sometimes in the difficulties that we encounter in the course of life, God is still showing his grace. You know, he could have let them continue to live for their pleasure. He could have let them build up their paneled houses, have fruitful crops. He could have let them have children who then forgot God, who didn't recognize the need for blood sacrifice for their sin, who didn't recognize their position as God's people to proclaim his glories to the nation. God could have let them go on and on in this path, but he didn't. He sent his prophet to confront them. And folks, God's confrontation is an act of God's grace in our lives. God's chastening is an act of God's providential grace in our lives. When God brings difficulty, sometimes it's God's redirection for our good and for his glory. God is gracious in his judgment. He deals with us sometimes in this way as well. Our blessings are not typically tied to the same things the blessings in the Old Testament was, land and crops and provisions. Our blessings are often spiritual in nature through the priority and the progress of the gospel, the spread of the gospel, the building up of the body of Christ. But sometimes we see these things frustrated in our life. And instead, we pursue our own goals and our own prosperity. And like this remnant, we find our pursuits frustrated. And when we find that frustration or lack of satisfaction, it's an act of the grace of God in our lives. And so we look at the balance sheet of our checkbook, and we don't seem to have enough, or our account seems to have holes, or we look at our clothing and it's not as fashionable as we would like it to be. Instead of looking at that, let's look at our own hearts and consider our own ways. Let's look at our own priorities and see if perhaps the failure to find satisfaction in our pursuits at its root is a failure to prioritize the pursuits of the Lord in our lives. One commentator said, Haggai's message extends far beyond the issue of financial resources or materialism. It speaks to priorities in general. And these are displayed vividly in our financial priorities, but they're also seen in the way we use our time, the way we set goals, our family expectations, what we see as successful in our lives. Well, lest you think, well, this is, again, you're still hanging out in the Old Testament just a little too long. Jesus said in Mark chapter 10, Peter said to Jesus, behold, we've left everything and followed you. And Jesus said, truly, truly, I say to you, there's no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or farms for my sake and for the gospel's sake, but that he will receive 100 times as much now in the present age, houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and farms, along with persecutions in the age to come, eternal life. And Jesus resets their expectations to spiritual expectations. You leave your family, you leave your farms, and you're going to gain a new family and a new farm, new prosperity, not a physical farm, but a spiritual crop of blessing as the sowed of the gospel, the seed of the gospel is sowed. And then 2 Corinthians, take a minute and turn over to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. I think this is just a great reminder. It's a great reminder for me, if no one else, but it's a good reminder of us, of God's provision for those who are generous towards him. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, starting at verse 6. This copy of my Bible has a title. Those titles are not inspired, but they help. It's called The Cheerful Giver. It says, the point is this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has made up his mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things, at all times, you may abound in every good work. As it is written, he has distributed freely, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in every way for all your generosity, which through us will produce thanksgiving to God. For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing in many thanksgivings to God. Don't forget that when you're generous with the resources God has given you, even though you feel like, man, I really can't afford to be generous toward the needs of the saints or to the work of the Lord, God says, I will bless that generosity by giving you all that you need to be generous, to continue to be generous. God is so good to bless us to be able to participate in the work of the gospel and the mission of the church through physical generosity. The last thing I want us to consider is consider the changes that are needed and the good, blessed results that this will bring, both for these people and for us today. Haggai encourages these people to choose to obey the Lord by doing what he has called them to do. He gives them very straightforward instructions. In verse 12, he says this, then Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet as the Lord their God had sent them. And the people feared the Lord. They had a message of confrontation. That message became one of correction. And then they made God's house a priority again in their life. God's work became a priority. They chose to obey the Lord by doing what he had called them to do. Whether we eat or drink or whatever we do, we should do all to the glory of God. And the gracious intervention of God's providence allows us to reestablish priorities of serving him. whatever they may be, wherever they may be in your life. We should choose to be conscious of the sovereign providence of God in our life. Verse 12, the second part of that verse says, and the people feared the Lord. They decided, now we want to make it our utmost priority to obey the Lord. We're going to live in fear of awe and reverence to the Lord. And so we need to choose to be conscious of the sovereign providence of God in our life and choose to fear the Lord. And whatever, wherever that leads us, whatever that means for us, in our particular circumstances, we choose to act upon that fear of the Lord. We also choose to enjoy the blessings of God as we obey him. Look at verse 13 and 14. It says, then Haggai, the messenger of the Lord, spoke to the people with God's message. He said, I am with you, declares the Lord. Don't miss the significance of this. The beginning of the message, he calls them these people, not my people, but these people. And now, as they choose to follow the Lord, make rebuilding his house a priority in their lives, he says what? I am with you. God promises that he is with them. And this, as we see it played out, it's not only a promise of his presence being with them, but of his active blessing in their life. They'll go from being frustrated with their own pursuits to now being satisfied with their priorities, prioritizing the work of the Lord. He is supporting them. He is sustaining them. He provides for them. He makes their work successful. God is with them. Could we ask for anything greater than that, that God would be with us in all of our pursuits? One of the blessings of the gospel is that title, Emmanuel, which means what? God with us. One of the greatest blessings of the coming of Christ is that God is now with us. And one of the blessings of making God's work a priority in our life is that God will be with us in our pursuits. He will give us satisfaction and joy. And then finally, he enlivens them and encourages them in their work. It says here in this passage, he stirred up the spirit of all the people. I don't know about you, but I sometimes find myself discouraged in my work. I find myself frustrated. And what I need to do is search my own heart and search my own priorities. What am I looking to for satisfaction? Am I looking to the praise of men or to the glory of God? What am I looking to for satisfaction in my material things? Am I looking to having security in those things or comfort in those things? Or am I looking to being able to make use of those for the good of the church and the glory of God and spread of the gospel? Maybe some of the dissatisfactions that I feel in my own spirit are a result of selfish pursuits and wrong priorities. And as we realign our priorities with the priorities of glorifying God through the spread of the gospel and the building up of his body, I think we will see God enliven our spirits as well. He gives us joy, and I could probably stop my sermon right now and open up an opportunity for testimonies, and many of you would give testimony to exactly that. You've given yourself in priority to the work of the Lord. It might be a simple thing as those of you who write cards and send cards to those who are dealing with difficulties. And you found that that is a joyful pursuit and it brings a great deal of satisfaction. Or maybe it's those of you that minister in song and you sing and you're not doing it for your own glory, but you're doing it to encourage and edify the saints, and you find that is satisfying. God is blessing. Or you give a gift anonymously, or you give a gift personally to someone that feels like a financial sacrifice, and you see them react with gratitude and thanksgiving, and you're filled with joy, and you're blessed yourself as a giver. That is God glorifying, and that brings a great deal of satisfaction. Whatever it is, it could be 100 different things in each of our lives. I'm sure many of you could give testimony to how God enlivens your spirit and encourages you in this work. He stirs up the spirit of the people, and this is nothing short of divine empowering for your life and ministry to accomplish the work of God. Do we trust that God will enable us to do the work he's called us to do, even if it seems difficult or sacrificial? I think we'll see God bless, and we can hear testimonies of that. God stirs the leaders and the people to action. Verse 14 says, he says, the spirit of all, I'll back up, verse 14, and the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel and of Joshua and the spirit of all the remnant of the people. And they came and they worked on the house of the Lord of hosts, their God, on the 24th day of the month, in the sixth month, in the second year of Darius the king. God gave them the energy and the desire and the satisfaction of doing his work, making it a priority. And I want to encourage you today, this is not a message of confrontation, it's a message of encouragement. At least that's what it's meant to be. I want to encourage you to give yourself to the priorities that God gives to his church. The spread of the gospel, the provision for the saints, the provision of needs, the building up of the body of Christ in the church for testimony of the gospel. That's where we'll find true satisfaction. That's where we will experience the presence of God with us. That's where we will find true joy and blessings as God's New Testament people. I'll close with an illustration. Hudson Taylor, another missionary. I love reading about missionaries and talking about them. He told an older minister, God has called me to spend my life in missionary service in China. The minister says, how do you propose to go there? And Hudson says, I don't know, but I think it likely that I shall need to go as the 12 and the 70 disciples did in Judea, without stick or bag or food or money, relying on Jesus who had sent me to supply my needs. The minister said, oh, my boy, as you grow older, you'll become wiser than that. Such an idea might have done very well in the days of Christ when he himself was on the earth, but not now. At that point, Hudson Taylor was 18 years old. Many years later, Taylor recalled this incident, and he wrote, I have grown older since then, but not any wiser, at least not worldly wiser. I am more and more convinced that if we were to take the directions of our master and the assurance he gave to his first disciple more fully as our guide, we should find them just as suited to our times as to those to which they were originally given. May God bless us as we walk in obedience to him, as the Spirit applies this passage to your own life and circumstance, that you will live with great satisfaction in doing his will, in accomplishing the mission of Christ, in building up the body of the church. And that would be your greatest joy, to see God with you as you accomplish his work in his way. Let's pray, and then Warren's going to come and lead us in a closing song. Father, thank you for this reminder, Lord, from a long time ago, before Christ came, of the need we have to prioritize your work, to do your will, and see you work through us to accomplish that will. God, we live in a different world today with different priorities than they had, and yet the one thing remains constant, that you've called us to prioritize the mission of the gospel and the building up of your church. And so, God, help us to be dissatisfied unless that's a priority in our life. But as it becomes a priority in our lives, to be satisfied as we see you walking alongside of us and empowering and enlivening our spirits and giving us the ability to be generous and to be gospel proclaimers, support the work of the word around the world and also in this community. Lord, I pray that you would frustrate self-centered efforts, but, God, that you would empower God-centered efforts. For your glory and for our good, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
We'll close with Charles Wesley's text that we began with. The first stanza is aspirational, to proclaim glory of Christ. The second stanza is a prayer to ask for assistance from God as we do that. Let's stand and sing over 1,000. Let's do it. Have a good Sunday afternoon. Good day.